Hello, my name is Stéphane Devim. I'm from Université Grenoble-Alpes in France. I will now talk about stabilization, leader election, and highly dynamic networks. This is a joint work with Karine Altizen, Anaïs Durand, Colette Jonen, and Franck Petit. By stabilization, we usually mean self-stabilization, which is a general non-masking property to handle transient undesired events, such as faults. Topological change, for example. However, there are many variants of self-stabilization, for example, pseudo-stabilization, weak stabilization, and snap stabilization. And so, in this talk, we will focus on pseudo-stabilizing algorithm. A self-stabilizing system starts from an arbitrary initial configuration, and what we have to ensure is that eventually the system reaches a so-called legitimate configuration from which it cannot deviate from its specification, which means that once a legitimate configuration is reached, every possible future will be correct. We don't have this guarantee with pseudo-stabilizing algorithm. Actually, in a pseudo-stabilizing system, we still start from an arbitrary initial configuration, but we have only to ensure that each execution has a correct suffix. So, by definition, every self-stabilizing algorithm is also a pseudo-stabilizing algorithm, but we have some pseudo-algorithms that are actually not self-stabilizing. And in this case, this means that we can always extend the incorrect prefix, which means that the size of the incorrect prefix cannot be bounded actually, even if at the end we always reach a correct suffix. And so we have considered those two kinds of stabilization in highly dynamic networks. And what is important here is that topological change are not transient, like we usually do in self-stabilization, but they are frequent. So this means that they are not an anomaly, but rather they are inherent to the nature of the system itself. And so we have focused our work on the problem of leader election. We have n identified processes, so each process holds a unique identifier, and this identifier is taken in a definition domain, ID set whose size is bigger than n. So this means that if we take a value in this set, we either this value is the identifier of some processes, and in this case the value is said to be a real identifier, or this value is not attached to any process, and in this case the value is said to be a fake identifier. To designate the leader, every process computes an output which should contain the identifier of the leader. However, as the initial configuration is arbitrary, initially some of the outputs may contain fake identifiers. So, despite this, the goal is to converge to a configuration from which all outputs constantly designate the same real identifier. We consider a synchronous model. So every synchronous round consists first in for a process to send information to its predecessor, its successor, sorry. These successors are a priori unknown. Then the process receives information from its a priori unknown predecessor, makes some local computation, and finally updates its state. So, as we consider dynamic networks, the set of successor and predecessor of every process may evolve along the time. And to model this, we consider the model of dynamic graphs. So, a dynamic graph is an infinite sequence of graphs, characteristic graphs. And the first graph of the sequence gives the network topology in the first round, the second one in the second round, and so on. Maybe the most important concept in dynamic graphs is the concept of journée. So, for example, we want to know whether a process D can transmit information to process A. If we look at this dynamic graphs, we know that during the first round, D can transmit an information to C. Then in the second round, C can transmit information to B. In the third round, the information can stay in B. And finally, in the fourth round, B can transmit the information to A. And so we obtain this sequence, which is a journey from D to A of length 4. To obtain length 4, we compute the difference between the arrival time and the departure time plus 1. Using the concept of journey, we can define a source. A source is a process that can infinitely often reach any other processes through a journey. We can have timing guarantees. So a quasi-timely source can infinitely often reach any other through a journey of length at most delta. But the time between two journeys of length at most delta can be unbounded. And finally, a timely source can always reach any other through a journey of length at most delta. We have also the concept of sink. A sink can infinitely often be reached by any other through a journey. And similarly, we have quasi-timely sink and timely sink. In a previous paper, we have considered classes of dynamic graphs where all processes are sources. And so they are also actually sinks. So we have the class where all processes are sources, the class where all processes are quasi-timely sources, and finally, the class where all processes are timely sources. So in the present paper, we consider a generalization, an obvious generalization, where we have at least one source or at least one sink instead of all sources and all sinks. So we have now six other classes. And so we obtain this hierarchy. In the graph below, an arrow means that an arrow between A and B means that A is strictly included into B. And from the previous paper, we know that self-stabilization can be achieved in all classes where all processes are source. So the idea here is to extend the previous results to more general classes and to try to find the limits where stabilizing linear relation become impossible. And we have also studied lower bounds on the stabilization time. First, our first result is that in the new classes we consider, self-stabilization is actually impossible. And so we have decided to consider a weaker property, namely pseudo-stabilization, to see whether we can do something interesting in those classes. And our results are the following. Pseudo-stabilizing linear relation is impossible in most of those classes, except in the class where there is at least one timely source. So the limit is actually in these classes. So we will now focus on these classes. So recall that in this class, we have at least one timely source, that is to say, at least one a priori unknown process that can always reach any other through a journey of length at most delta. First, let's see why self-stabilization is impossible. We consider two almost identical networks, where the only difference is that Py here is replaced by Px here. In the first situation A, all processes designate Py as leader. This is the same in situation B. Every process different of Py here have the same state in situation B. The problem is that in situation B, Py is a fake identity. Assume that all processes except Py on the left and Px on the right are connected at any time with any other processes. This means that all these processes are actually timely sources. And so this is why this pattern belongs to the class we consider here. Then, for all these processes, their execution is in situation A is indistinguishable with situation B. So if process PG elect PY in A, then it also elect PY in B, which is forbidden since PY is a fake ID in situation B. So this means that to make the election succeed in B, PY should eventually change its leader, and so it will do it also in A. Consider now that we have a self-stabilizing algorithm. We have at least one legitimate configuration where the outputs should be constant. So for example, we can assume that PY is the elected processes. But in this case, we can apply the previous results. And so situation A is possible, which means that eventually one process changes its output, which means that the starting configuration was not legitimate and we obtain a contradiction. So self-stabilization is impossible. Let's see how we can solve pseudo-stabilizing leader election. So our goal is to elect what we call a stable process. A stable process is a process such that eventually all other processes receive, maybe indirectly, information about it at least every data round. At each round, each process in the algorithm will initiate a flooding related delta time. So since there are sources, there exist also stable processes by definition. So now we should be able to evaluate the stability level of every process. We use suspicion counters for that. A process increments its suspicion counter each time it is accused to be not stable by some other process. And we have that after the first round, suspicion counters are monotonically non-decreasing. So to select the leader a process, we select a process with the minimum suspicion counter value. And in case there are several, we will use identifier to break ties. To do this, every process maintains two maps. In the L stable map, a process stores information about locally stable process at P. That is to say, P itself and processes from which P directly received information at most delta rounds ago. And finally, in the gstable map, we store information about globally stable process, that is process that are locally stable at any process P included. And this map should eventually contain at least every stable process. Remark that P is always consider itself as both locally and globally stable. Inside the map, what we store is triplets. In the triplets, we have the identifier of the locally or globally stable process, the suspicion value we know about him, it, and a time to live value. Then the two maps are appended and updated with received information. For the updates in the locally stable map, the information with the highest TTL is always considered with the as the freshest one, and so this is the one that will be finally written. For the updates in JStable, it's a bit different. Received information are always considered as fresher, and so inserted, but with a TTL equal to delta. And finally, triplet is removed from a map when its TTL value reaches zero. Now, how the algorithm works? At every arm, each process P initiates a flooding of the triplet containing its identifier, its map of locally stable process, and a TTL equal to delta. Then, P updates its two maps according to the received triplets. Then the TTL variable, except those associated to P, are decremented, and expired triplets are deleted from maps. For each received maps, If the identifier of the process is absent, the process increments its suspicion counter. And finally, P choose its header in the gestable map. And so this is a process with a lowest suspicion counter, as explained before. Thanks to the time to live value, we can easily delete fake IDs. Now, we have also properties about sources. So let's consider one source, S. What we know is that, thanks to the flooding, every process different from S regularly receives every data rounds, triplets initiated by S. So those triplets contain the identifier of S, its the value of its locally stable map, and the TTL. So since P regularly receives those triplets, the identifier of the source is eventually forever present in its map, and so this means that eventually the identifier of every source forever belongs to every locally stable map for every process. And as a consequence, the source is eventually no more accused, and so the suspicion value of every source is eventually forever constant. Also, the identifier of the source is inside the map is sent in every flooding. So this means that eventually the identifier of the source forever belongs to every gestable map forever for every process P. And we have also an interesting property for each process whose suspicion counter is eventually constant. Indeed, if the, by definition, the identifier of X eventually forever belongs to the locally stable map of every source, since otherwise, message containing not X will reach X and it will increment its counter. And so, as a consequence, since every process regularly receives information from every source, the identifier of X is eventually forever inside the G stable map of every process P. If we consider now a process that is infinitely often absent from some G stable map, this means that infinitely often during delta consecutive rounds, the process does not receive, only receives message where X, the identifier of X is absent. Some of those triplets were initiated by sources. So X also receives this letter, and consequently, X increments its counter infinitely often. So overall, eventually, every process with an eventually constant suspicion counter forever belongs to the gestable map of every process. And we have at least one of these processes since we have sources. Moreover, suspicion counter of all other processes increase from time to time, and so they are eventually greater than every constant suspicion counter. This means that eventually every process selects the same process, which is a stable process, and we are done. So we have studied the expressive power of pseudo and self-stabilizing leader election in 9 classes of dynamic graphs, and this is what we obtain. The limit seems to be in the class where there is at least one timely source, and we have also shown that in this class, despite we can obtain a pseudo-stabilizing solution, we cannot bound its convergence time. However, we show that speculation is possible, which means that in general, we cannot bound the convergence time, but we can do it, you can bound the convergence time in an interesting subclass, actually, the class where all processes are timely sources. For future work, the space complexity is still an open question. We have 2 classes where we have either a pseudo-stabilizing algorithm or a self-stabilizing algorithm, but in those classes, our algorithm use an unbounded memory. So we don't know whether it's possible to do the same, but with a bounded memory. And we want also in the future extend our work to other problems and to study the expressiveness of those two properties in general. Thank you very much.